We're in London for a series of conversations, and we began with Lord John Browne, the CEO of British Petroleum, the world's second largest oil company. BP has more oil exploration in the United States than any other company. John Browne has headed the company since 1995, overseeing a massive expansion that included merging with the U.S. giant Amoco. This year, its profits are expected to surpass $20 billion. Lord Browne has attracted some attention because he has been candid in his assessment of environmental issues and creating for BP the slogan, Beyond Petroleum. It's a pleasure to have Lord Browne back on this program, and especially here in London. Thank you. It's great to see you.
It's good to be back.
Let me talk about supply and demand. First of all, record profits this year, 2005. Yes?
Indeed.
Are most of the top oil companies going to take those profits and spend them on exploration?
There will be a limit to what I think they can all do. Certainly I can talk about BP. There's a limit to what you can do, and the limit is set by, of course, the available opportunities, because in the private sector is actually boxed in, if you will. Most of the oil and gas in the world is in the hands of states that are doing their own business.
Iran, Saudi Arabia.
It goes on, Mexico, for example.
Venezuela.
So Venezuela. So there's a sort of a slight boxing in. It's different for every company. So there's a limit to what can be done. There's also a limit, which is an interesting limit, which is established as a consequence. And that was that when prices were low, the engineering companies, the service companies, kept laying people off. They had to survive. And now we find with all the demands in the industry today, there aren't enough services to be provided in order for the companies to do their business.
And experienced people.
And experienced people. So we experience inflation, we experience shortage. You know, there's a great need, for example, for engineers. This is not a new thought. We've all been saying the number of engineers being graduated is low. They're being graduated in great numbers in China and India. But there's a limit to the amount of work you can take there, and there's a limit to the amount of people you can take elsewhere.
And you contributed to a pipeline that's just been opened from the Caspian Sea to the Mediterranean. Does that add to supply?
Absolutely. It adds 1 million barrels a day to world oil supply. That's quite significant on the margin, and that's brand new oil. That's not substitution, and that'll be up and running at the end of this year. I mean, lots of things are, you know, happening. The big issue, I think, for people to think about is this, that this is not like making a chocolate bar. We can't do it very quickly. The time from the idea, you know, where is the oil, to delivering it is probably 10 years at least, at least. So we're still trying to work out a way, for example, of delivering gas from Alaska, from the Great Prudhoe Bay gas cap. We know the gas is there. We're still in the process of finalizing that, and if we're lucky, that gas will come to the US market in 2015. A long time, a long time. So I think one thing to conjure with is the time scales, and you have to keep doing this, and you have to think about the future before the future arrives.
There's been no refinery built in the United States in the last, what, 8, 9 years?
Since about the mid-70s.
That much longer. Mm. Will there be refineries built in the United States?
Yes, they will. They will probably be expansions and extensions of existing refineries. There are a lot of things going on. We indeed have our own plans we've had in place for some time to do that in the northern part of the United States. The world as a whole has quite a lot of refining capacity, probably more than it needs. For example, India is in surplus, Europe's in surplus. That's why, for example, products are going to America at the moment. The big problem is what sort of products in which sort of places. And to an extent, the decisions are very commercial. They're based on economics. It's sometimes better to make something close in, sometimes better to import it from elsewhere. So the question of refineries is a complex one. In the end, the places where demand will grow the fastest will need more refineries than they have at the moment. China and India, for example, will definitely need more refineries at the right moment. The United States needs to re-examine its refineries, and I think we need to make sure that there aren't any regulatory or bureaucratic hurdles to expanding refineries in a proper and responsible way, both along the Gulf Coast and in the northern part of the United States.
When you say the northern part of the United States, do you mean Alaska?
No, I mean the northern part of the continental United States. I mean Illinois and Ohio, basically.
Let me talk about Alaska for a second and come back. If there is drilling is allowed in Anwar, would you drill there?
It depends. I think what we've done is we've said it's a wider issue for BP. It's a wider issue which covers the whole world. You know, what are the sensitive areas in the world and what are the things we want to see done before we'd even consider drilling there? And so we've adopted an approach which says, actually around the world, there are very sensitive places. They've been classified by the IUCN, it's a environmental agency, into categories 1 to 6. At 6, there are very few issues. 5, there are very few issues. 4 to 1, the issues get tougher and tougher and tougher.
And how do you make a decision then in terms of?
I think you have to examine yourself and ask yourself, could you do this without violating your standards? Could you do this in a way where you could stand up and say, I'm doing this with no or minimal impact, and I can do it in a way where if something went wrong, I could make sure I could clean up the mess and not permanently damage anything. These are tough, tough standards. So there is by no means any conclusion that once open, BP will be there. We'd have to examine it very, very carefully on the balance of all the information and, of course, our belief of whether oil is there. We won't explore, of course, in places where we don't think there's a chance of finding something.
We don't know because no one has had an opportunity to drill yet. You made a famous speech at Stanford. In which you basically, for the first time, an oil company executive stepped forward to say global warming is a problem and talked about environmental implications of the business you were in. It set BP apart. You then launched a campaign on television to talk beyond petroleum, seeming to suggest that British Petroleum had interest and went beyond the selling of oil. What did you mean? I mean, it was a slogan on television, but it was a point of contact between consumers and a company.
Most definitely. We in BP have a firm belief that there are the twin issues that face people. One is how secure are supplies, and the second one is, and what do supplies of energy do to the climate of the world? I think people are much more convinced now, at least around the world, that there is a real case to take precautionary action to avoid carbon concentrations going to beyond a critical level in the atmosphere. So for BP...
When you say people, I mean, do you think the United States is convinced of that?
I actually think people as opposed to representatives. Okay. And if you look... If you talk
a broad consensus among...
Indeed, many surveys show, even in the United States, that, you know, a large percentage of the population is concerned about this. They are concerned about it. So they express their concerns in different ways, of course, depending on the particular localities, and the order in which people's concerns come up depends on their general state of development and well-being. So for BP, we said that beyond petroleum meant two things. One is recognizing that petroleum will be used for many, many years. There are, you know, 60 years worth of supplies at least, that we have to think differently. We have to say, well, given petroleum, can we do things like take the carbon out of it, which we're beginning to experiment with on a very big scale? Can we produce fuels for cars that produce less CO2? Can we run our operations reducing the amount of emissions BP makes in its day-to-day operations?
Is the answer to those three questions so far yes,
yes.
Or maybe?
No, it's a yes.
Okay.
It's a yes. It's taken us years to get to the point where we can now say we can make produce hydrogen from hydrocarbons, and we can take the carbon, because hydrocarbons is hydrogen carbon, take it away and store it permanently in old oil and gas reservoirs. So we're now mounting a project on a big scale to do that, producing the world's first hydrogen power station. We can produce, and we are producing, products that produce less CO2. We have reduced our emissions of our operations by a very significant amount back to the 1990 base level. So that's one thing. Beyond that, we then are investing in alternative energies. And many people think, well, that's just a plaything.
Or it's very tiny, they think.
Well, it is tiny because the rest is so big. But I would argue within itself, it actually has the beginnings of a real business. We don't do this as charity. We have to do this as business.
Over the next 25 years, rising to what percentage you know, of the fuel demands of the world?
Impossible to say, but I think it's not unreasonable. You know, forecasting is terribly difficult. To see growth rate factors in 10 years of up to 10 times in this sort of area through wind and solar, decarbonized fuels, this is where you take the carbon off, and things which aren't quite clean, but things as CCGT.
Possibly up to 10% of the energy demand can be satisfied
no,
by...
No, not 10%. No, a tenfold increase.
Oh, maybe up to 2%, 3%?
Well, I think it may be up to 4%, possibly, globally. But it will matter more... The 4% is a big global average. So it will matter in certain locations where you can do this. In other locations, you can't.
Do you think that... Take the top four oil executives running the top four oil and energy companies. They share your view on global warming. David O'Reilly? Lee Raymond? You?
I think...
Or is there a difference of opinion?
Charlie, I put it this way. I think that when we made our statement, when I made it on behalf of BP in 1995, all I remember from that event is when the API told me that I'd left the church.
API is the American Petroleum Institute.
That's correct. I didn't quite understand what that meant, but I broadly understood the tone.
So the church was saying, the church meaning all of us who have a vested interest in the future of oil prices and oil development, oil everything, you left the church and you were committing heresy.
Yes. Yes. Now, and what I find very, very pleasing, it's a very important thing, is that people have moved a very, very long way.
People in the industry?
People in the industry have moved a very, very long way. People express their views differently. They say, we have to be more efficient. We have to be cleaner. Some are very explicit in saying, we must reduce carbon. But the shift has been enormous, enormous. I remember a time when we were trying to do things like reduce flaring. This is the burning of natural gas waste, and saying we won't do that, where our co-venturers, and I won't mention them, said to us, in that case, you have to pay for that 100%.
You want to eliminate that, pay for it.
Yes. Now, this discussion doesn't happen. Doesn't happen. So it's a much more, it's moved a long way, hardly surprising, given what people now say is the need for precautionary action. You know, I remember the G8 summit's just taking place, and the remarkable thing is climate change was on the agenda, and it was done in a very public and popular way. But part of that was all the academies of science and engineering in the G8 countries all said, we need to do something about this.
Tony Blair was on record then as saying there is no question that the burning of fossil fuel contributes to global warming.
It can certainly contribute to carbon in the atmosphere. We think that there's a very strong chance that the link is between that and global warming. I would say most scientists would say it's not proven, but the balance of probability is so strong you can't take a risk. You have to take out insurance. It's no good. It's no good, you know, taking out insurance after the burglar's been. So you've got to do things now to take the precaution to stop it happening.
And what do you say to those who say, Lord Brown, your responsibility to the stockholders, and we recognize, and you know that, and you've done a very good job for the BP stockholders, but also, is this as much a propaganda, is a public relations idea, as it is something that will change the way your company, and perhaps change the way the oil industry goes about its business?
Absolutely not. So what I'm concerned about is this. No business, I believe in no business in the world can conduct its business as if it's separate from its customers and society. In the end, it requires a license to operate, permission to do one transaction, then another, then another, then another, to be what is now called sustainable business. This is an issue which, if left uncontrolled, would, I believe, reduce the space, the license, for the business to operate. So in my mind, we are actually doing something which opens up more possibilities of creating shareholder value rather than reducing it. In addition, I do believe that there is a very valid business in alternative energies, which BP one day will participate in at scale.
But do you think that's how many years off?
Well,
it's
I think
a valuable business.
Probably more than five, but within 10 years.
Sometimes a prevailing wisdom, prevailing conversation is, I don't want to say wisdom, conventional wisdom, is that oil companies want to see gas-guzzling cars because it'll mean more demand for gasoline, and that you're resistant to hybrids. My impression is that's not your point
of
view, and I know that others have said that to me.
I don't think it's true. I mean, in the end, I come back to saying, you know, we're in this as part of society. We're not separate and apart. And I think doing something at the expense of society in the end doesn't work. And I think the history of business and the history of the development of business demonstrates that. When you violate the good of society, in the end something happens to you, which isn't good. So I think you participate with society. And my view is strong that you know, people should consume energy with responsibility, with caution. Don't waste it. Don't waste it. Now, of course, consumer choice is on the other hand. You know, people have fought long and hard to have choice, so it's up to them. But at least have the choices responsibly.
Well, in fact, the hybrid demand for hybrid cars was the impetus came from consumers, not from anything else.
That's correct.
I think they pretty much dictated to the automobile companies that they needed to change their lineup.
That's
of
right.
available vehicles.
That's right. I mean, I find very interesting, some very interesting facts, that even with high gasoline prices, people still look to buy and still buy gasolines that produce less emissions. Mm. They could choose to do something else, but they don't. I think that says something about the way consumers behave and think about this. It's a very important point, I believe.
Environmental questions are part of the demand equation, supply equation. Also, it is the political environment in which oil is located.
That's right.
How do you face up to that question? And what is the demand in terms of what kind of challenges do you meet when you are dealing with dictators? Mm-hmm. You're also dealing with where there's all kinds of political demands in terms of corruption. And you're also dealing with countries in which you may not have much admiration for the political government in place. Without ascribing either of those to the particular country, you have said that BP, I think, will not invest in Iran.
Correct? That's correct. I mean,
and that's 10% of the oil revenues in the world.
Would it were
oil reserves?
Let me say, would it were the other case? Well, the way that there is a meeting of minds between Iran and the rest of the world, and it was a place we could go. But right now, I would say, it's not a place that we can consider. I hope that would change.
How about Venezuela?
Well, Venezuela we're in at the moment, so we are presently looking at the present situation and seeing, you know, what can
Does
we do?
Mr. Chavez concern you?
Certainly it concerns me. I'm always concerned when there are big changes to existing agreements. That's always a problem. You know, that's always a concern.
The nationalization of?
We don't know whether it's nationalization or not. We don't know that yet. But it's of great concern.
And that's Central Asia.
Well, we are in Central Asia. But rather than taking it step by step, because we can go around the whole world.
Well, I was intending
basically,
to.
We're in most of the places.
Right, I was going to go to Russia and other places, but go ahead.
I think there are several dimensions to think about. First, I think the important point about oil and gas business is it's risky. It's risky. I know people tend to think it's not. But for the evidence, for example, of Hurricanes Katrina and Rita alone and the impact on the profits of BP demonstrates that we need to be of such a scale and reach that we can withstand the risks that take place. Mm-hmm. The same is true in politics. We are a business that must provide to a nation something which is of interest to them and interest to us, and keep that interest going. We call this a mutuality. There has to be a mutual interest between the two. And we have to do it in such a way that we don't violate our own standards, our code of conduct. So that inevitably limits what we can do. And we can't just do everything, go anywhere, and do it in the way which we wake up one morning and say, oh, that's a good idea, we'll do it that way.
You mean by that you can't simply pay off people, and even though it might make
people,
it more efficient to do so?
We can't feather the nest of politicians. We can't say fine, no environmental standards. We can't say, oh, employees, well, we'll treat them, you know, like factors of production rather than human beings. We can't and we won't do those sorts of things. However, that, I think, is something you put in the back of your head, front of mind, in the back of your head and in front of mind when you begin to negotiate your way into a country. Sometimes it doesn't work. You say, I can't do this. Other times you say, I can do this, and just maybe, a little bit of leadership might actually change what's going on in the country. We do things in such a way as to underpin. I'm always struck, you know, this comes back to the big questions of globalization and who gets what, right, and how do you do it. So we appear in a country, we have to, I think, ask ourselves, what are we leaving behind? Because we're certainly taking out oil and gas, we're selling it, often on behalf of nations, but in the end, and it's a wasting business. So in the long term, the question is, what do we leave? So we have to think about that too. You know, can we create better
enterprise? What's your responsibility to these countries?
Well, it's about, I think, primary responsibility to us. I think we have to be centered about that, which is we need to build business that can repeat again and again. Which means we need to identify the locality with globalization. This is the paradox of globalization that we attend to in a very practical way. So we have to leave people, give them the opportunity to aspire to go from the local into the global BP, or at least get bettered through education and experience. When we buy things, we have to make sure that we can develop enterprise in the country as well as procure them globally. We have to make sure, as we're doing in other several countries that who are rich in energy, but yet the population is poor in energy, the bottom of the pyramid, people needing things to light their homes, solar panels, or have gas to cook with, LPG in bottles, rather than use lighting paraffin or organic material that creates so much smog that people die of lung disease. And that could be avoided by providing people with very small devices to cook. So we're doing that in various parts of the world. These are the things we have to think about, which allow us, therefore, to provide some benefits of being global locally, allow us to do business along with our standards. And if none of that works, then we can't do business. So we have to choose. We have to have enough scale to be able to choose and to do the business in a responsible way in the countries that we're in. Now, things always go wrong. Let me immediately say things go wrong. They're always aberrations. They're things which every day need to be fixed in one way or another, because the best laid plans of men, I'm afraid, go asunder.
When you look at the cushion in terms of supply, it's reduced from where it has been. How much is it? How close are we to full capacity now?
We don't actually know. But over this year, probably about 1.5 million barrels a day, playing an average in the past of 3 million barrels a day. So it's very tight. The reason why people think it's tight is 1.5 million barrels a day, of course, could easily be lost. Let's suppose, and let's hope it doesn't happen, that production from Iraq gets cut, right, for example. So it's a lower level than we're used to. So that has to be restored. I think the world would feel better if there were a better cushion in supply.
My impression is that the Saudis within OPEC, you know, have pretty much said that we're not going to restrict demand in order to have the price go up, that we, in fact, understand the crisis we're in. Mm. Is that a fair appraisal of what they've
That's
done?
That's what they've said, and they're trying to do that. They're trying to do that, both short and long term.
Well, most of the profits that have been earned here in 2005 be used for exploration? Because the exploration is up to $180 billion when you look at all the...
Right. It's all going up. I mean, first of all, the amount the global industries are spending is going up, and so every company will put the amounts up. It will not, I think, absorb the total profits which are generated, because there are bottlenecks, there are problems with the private sector being in a box. After all, a lot of the opportunities are in the hands of state companies. OPEC and the like, and Mexico and so forth. Secondly, there's been a problem in the past of investment in what I call the supply and engineering services sector. That is, those are the people who provide the means whereby where oil and gas companies can do their business, engineering platforms, providing pipe, providing well logging services, and so forth. And there simply isn't enough of that to do everything everybody wants immediately. And that sector, of course, has to be shared not just by the private sector, but also by the state sector and OPEC. So you will see some increase, but it won't be all of it. So some of these profits will almost certainly be used, well, I don't know what they'll be used for, but they'll probably be used for buying back stock, maybe for investment and diversification. Who knows what will happen to it.
Do you expect to see more consolidation?
Difficult to say.
We just had the Unocal and Sinuk and Chevron making them.
My guess is,
fight.
Without picking a time, I come back to saying, in the end, I think there will be, because there are too many companies in this sector. And the sector, of course, is, while the companies all look pretty big, you know, I mean, even a medium-sized independent is a big company by market capitalization compared with other companies. All the companies in the world are sharing only a small portion of the accessible reserves of the world, because we mustn't confuse the fact that the world has many reserves and resources, but actually most of them are in the hands of state companies or quasi-state companies. So the playing field in which the private sector is working globally is very much smaller. Let's say it's a fifth of, at most I would say, of the resources of the world. So the rest of it is in the hands of states. So probably too crowded, and we've seen it happen recently with some acquisitions.
China, the rise of China. You're on your way to India, and the rise of China, and some people talk about sort of the, you know, the focus of the global economic shifting to China and Asia. Tell me how you see that, and what the implications of that for the economics of the world.
Well, the first thing I observe is extraordinary growth in the available talent pool. There are extraordinary people, and everybody's taking education and betterment very, very seriously. And so great people are being generated, and they're being deployed in a semi-market-based economy. So many are going into business, they're doing activity, and they're generating ideas and growth. And more people are coming, obviously, from the rural parts of China into cities, and they want to participate in this great development surge. So growth is on the basis, I think, of the human capacity. The limitations are, of course, many of the resources they need. It is curious that Russia, China, look at each other. Russia has large resources and limited need for these resources. Population which is shrinking,
right.
And China has no resources, a population which is expanding in its wealth. And there are interesting examples of two different ends of the spectrum. In our business, the matter which worries China is, of course, energy.
And do you find yourself, as the executive of the second largest private energy company in the world, competing with the Chinese, in which their companies are 70 or 80% state-owned, in an aggressive way, because they're aggressively moving around to make contracts to ensure their own oil supply?
Absolutely. We've seen them all over the place. Now, it turns out that we, BP, have not competed with them. Whether that's because we've avoided competition or whether we just haven't been competing in the same place, I don't know. But it's evident they're all over the world. Looking for sources of oil and gas, contracts, exploration, all sorts of things. And indeed, we've been for a long time wanting to work with the Chinese, as we're now doing in Angola, to do just that.
West Africa is a place where there's a lot of possibilities in terms of future drilling.
Absolutely, yes. Angola, Nigeria, still a very powerful oil and gas provinces for the future.
Finally, you have, according to what I have read, in terms of your financial planning at BP, are looking at an oil price of $40 a barrel over the next 5 years as your benchmark for investment purposes at BP.
That's right.
Why do you think $40 is the appropriate mark?
Well, there's no right answer in this, and I can assure you that we never use one number and not look at a whole array of them. I mean, forecasting the price of oil, which is of course based on supply and demand, but it's also based on political shifting.
Right.
It is very, very difficult to do. So we look at a range of, we look at $40, we look in the longer term, and I don't know when the longer term works, because we believe in supply and demand affecting prices, in a broad range of $20 to $35. So, but for the medium term, we say it's not impossible to use $40. Whether $40 is simply the average of $60 today and $20 yesterday, which was the average in the 90s, yeah, who knows? But $40, when you look at everything, seemed about right for the next 5 years. You never know. And it's very unwise, I think, to bet, literally bet a company on one number. You need to see something inherently important in what you're doing, not just in the mathematics of it.
Can you imagine oil going to $100 a barrel?
It's difficult for me to imagine that. Maybe I'm weighed down with history. Could it go there for an
instant? There's a political change in governments and all of that that might, or war and revolution and...
It's all possible. It's all possible, and maybe it could go to a spike for a very short period of time. Maybe it could do that. But I look through it all and say, but in the end, you know, people don't want to buy things which are too expensive. And the human race goes a mile to invent when they need to. They do a lot of things. They invent efficiency. We all invent efficiency. We invent substitution. We invent all sorts of things. Science and engineering and human behavior together will make a big difference here.
What worries you most about the future?
Always the question of stability in the world. You never know how the interrelationship of nations works. You know, who in the end will create a fault line somewhere that makes it difficult to be optimistic about the future. I'm an optimist. I always believe that this is a generation that, if you will, and I wouldn't want to be depressing, can actually die peacefully in their beds. This is a generation to do that. That's a great privilege. I just hope we don't mess it up.
Thank you. Pleasure to have you on the broadcast.
Thank you.
Lord John Browne is CEO of BP. Back in a moment. Stay with us. We're in London.
Sir Jeremy Greenstock is here. He is the director of the Ditchley Foundations in England. He is the former British Special Representative to Iraq and also the former British Ambassador to the United Nations. I am pleased to have him here with us in London after many appearances while he was in New York and even after he left as UN Ambassador from Great Britain. Welcome.
Welcome to London, Charlie.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here. You still believe, notwithstanding all the problems and all the mistakes that have been made on many sides, by Iraqis, by Americans, by the British even, that there is the possibility of an Iraqi, stable Iraqi government that will emerge from this, in which Sunnis and Shia and Kurds can live together.
Yes, it's possible. It's not yet formed.
What is the motivating energy that's bringing it together rather than tearing it apart?
The fact that if Iraq fell apart, even into three main communities, all of them would be worse off than if they were united. I think the leaderships in all three main communities, obviously I would say the leaderships with the right point of view, but the leaderships that have their people's long-term interests in heart all know that they would be worse off split than together. And I think that's coming through quite strongly in the way that they're all behaving. But there are moments when they want to make sure that their sectarian interests, out of history, out of the fact that the Shia were crushed and pushed to one side by the previous regimes, out of the fact that the Kurds were attacked brutally and with chemical weapons by the central government, out of the fact that the Sunnis, having been or having felt that they were the leading community in Iraq for centuries, are now in a minority. Out of all of that, they have got to realize, and I think they do realize, that this Iraq must be created in a new way for the interests of everybody into the future.
Do you think that the possibility of civil war is 50-50?
No, for the following. I think the possibility of degradation of the security situation in Iraq is there because the men, materials, and motivation behind the bombings and the attacks and the killings of civilians is there. I don't think it will collapse into civil war if it collapses. I think that the Iraqi people have got more tolerance at the moment for it not to collapse. But I think it would break down into a number of local baronies where the militias ruled, where local warlords ruled, and the central authority would lose its influence. I don't think there will be a massive Shia versus Sunni great civil war as in the history of our countries.
So the central truth for you about Iraq today is what?
The central truth is two things. One, we released something which collectively, Americans and Brits, we didn't understand could be so dangerous or be such a difficult thing to control, and therefore we didn't prepare for it in the way that we should have done. Second, that we have released a people from dictatorship who have a remarkable talent for bearing pain, for keeping going, for wanting government with the consent of the people, not Western democracy, but government with the consent of the people in a religious-minded state, and a people who have a tendency to violence and to schism out of the schisms of the past, both those things. That mix we are learning about in detail, in painful detail, because we didn't do our homework before. But it was all there in the history. We just hoped it would go better. That hope has not been realized. Therefore, our work has got to be stronger, better resourced, and more sustained because we made that original mistake. That's my view.
And the original mistake was?
Not to ensure that we could deal with a worst-case scenario rather than a better-case scenario.
Was that part of the debate? Now I'm talking about your book. You've written a book that's gotten some attention because it has not yet been published. What's the title?
Its running title at the moment is The Cost of War.
Speaking of that, is there any question in your mind whether this war was worth it?
I say that it hasn't been proved. If Iraq
You can't say yes or no at this point.
No, that's the point of what I'm trying to write. That it's up to Iraqis to prove that it was worth it. And then I think it will be worth it for us. But the cost has been extremely high, particularly in men, but also in dollars. And it didn't need to be that high, and we must learn some lessons from that. If the book is in a sensitive area, it may have to wait until some of those sensitivities have gone away before I publish it in the way that I want.
Let me understand this. You've written a book.
I've written a text.
A text. And it's being held up because there's objection to you from the government because of some of the things that you report, which were part of the history of your experience at the United Nations, that they don't think is in the best interest of the national security of the country to be published now.
Well, it's broader than that. I'm in an absolutely open and friendly conversation with my previous colleagues about whether it's right for a civil servant to say some of the things that I think ought to be said. If we don't come to an agreement on that, I'll wait until it's less sensitive. I'm writing not for history, not to be dramatic, not to reveal anything. I don't reveal very much. There are all sorts of things that I'm not allowed to reveal, that I can't reveal. And that will be 30 years away when the papers are opened. But there are things to say for history, and I'd rather wait and say them for history than try and take on the debate now. It's not my job.
Do you think the administration in Washington was determined to go to war?
Yes. Well,
so what was the debate at the UN about?
with one qualification, that I think the president would have liked to remove Saddam and the threat of weapons of mass destruction without a war if it had been possible, like the prime minister. That's what I believe. But I don't think he believed that there was any route to do that, or he could trust Saddam to cough up everything that he had by way of challenge to the United States and to regional security.
And once you put troops on ships in the region, you were starting a clock.
Yeah, but you can stop a clock. You know, this is a powerful nation, your nation. You can stop a clock if you want to. The army does what it's told. It's very good at it. The second resolution in early 2003 was all about trying to get the Security Council together to put such pressure on Iraq that it gave up its weapons of mass destruction, as we thought they had, or they gave up their challenge in the region without a fight.
Oh, they made clear to you that you could do anything you wanted to do to come and search for yourself.
Yeah.
Which is what he didn't do in the end.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, he didn't follow the resolutions. He didn't cooperate with the UN inspectors. He didn't give up all the paperwork and all the materials that could have accounted for the destruction of the weapons of mass destruction previously. He just didn't want to give up the image of Iraq as possibly having WMD.
Because you were there, President Clinton has said repeatedly recently, and he said it for a while, that when he's asked about the war, he makes this point: I would have preferred there be more inspections before the invasion took place. That was my position, he said.
That was our position.
That was your position too. But that was not the American position. That was the difference between the UK position and the American position?
Yes, we wanted more time.
And the United States said no more time because they believed?
Well, because they believed that to do this militarily, you had to use the momentum that you built up, both domestically, in public opinion, and with the army, and internationally. And they believed that the UN were not going to do the job of stripping Saddam of the instruments that he should not have.
Do you believe the UN would have done the job of stripping him of whatever instruments, even though he didn't have the instruments?
Well, I think that might have come out with a bit more time, that perhaps those instruments weren't there.
So this war wasn't necessary.
That's not necessarily the case. Looking back, you think we could have done this another way. At the time, remember, Charlie, either the president or the prime minister could have been held to account by their peoples for standing back and allowing Saddam to develop something that made him invulnerable and made him much more dangerous.
Some people are beginning to say the following: the only thing that stood between the United States' determination to go to war, beyond Saddam saying, you know, come in here and go at it, I have no weapons and you can look wherever you want to, the only thing that stood between the United States and going to war, other than Saddam doing that, was Britain. That if the British, the great ally of the United States, had said, no, we can't be with you on this, the administration would have had a second thought. If you had been able to convince them.
I think you should ask Secretary Rumsfeld about that. I don't think that it was necessary for the United States to have Britain with them. I don't think in the modern history of the United States a foreign voice has ever been capable of stopping an American government from doing what
they wanted to do. So nothing Britain could have done, no counsel, no wisdom, nothing would have stopped them?
Not if they wanted to do it.
Oh, you just said they wanted to do it.
Yes. If they wanted to do it, there was no way that a foreign voice was going to stop them. This is always, in the end, between senior Americans in positions of responsibility.
Tony Blair, the Prime Minister, has been reelected, notwithstanding the public opinion polls about the British attitude about the war, been reelected, and has viewed cover story in Newsweek, International This Week, and other places, you know, about him as sort of one of the dominant political figures in Britain, along with Margaret Thatcher, since World War II. In the end, why was he so committed to this? Was it because 9/11 had such a profound impact on him?
That's one reason. I think it did have a profound impact on him, and he saw the United Kingdom as being vulnerable to this kind of terrorism as well. There were, in my view, it's completely my perception. He'll have obviously.
Well, you were talking to him during this time. That's why you.
Well, I see two main things. One, he thought that Saddam Hussein was a threat and a danger to the United Kingdom, certainly in the medium term. Second, he wanted to stay with the one ally which was a serious global security player. There's no other. And when it comes down to a serious security question, you will find that the United Kingdom will stick with the United States, that there isn't another player in the world that has that kind of capacity or who is as close to us in security matters. And that was a primary reason for the Prime Minister taking the decisions that he took. But he was also particular about wanting Saddam, under UN resolutions, to be stripped of any of the weapons that he ought not to have possessed.
He wanted to see that happen. He wanted to see those UN resolutions enforced.
Correct.
And see a dictator.
Yes. For the sake of international order as well as the direct interests of the United Kingdom.
Today, is Iraq a breeding ground for terrorists? Is it sort of a place where terrorists are being trained to go elsewhere and challenge other governments in other places?
No. It's a place where terrorists are being hardened in battle, but a lot of them are being killed or being picked up or being imprisoned or being dealt with. If Iraq became a state where terrorists could train their people for operations elsewhere, we would have made things worse. That has not yet happened.
And when you look at your experience there, what did you learn that you didn't know about the way things work in Iraq?
That's a long story, Charlie. What don't you know? I mean, you have your own views, you're representing your government's
views.
Was
any startling observation you came out of and being there and being the equivalent of, you know, America's Bremer? I mean, UK's Bremer.
It taught me more clearly than just reading British history in Iraq in the earlier part of
Back
the 20th century, in the colonial era, in our handling of empire. It taught me that when you change a situation, when you create a new situation through your use of arms, you have got to ensure immediately you take over that you have the security situation under control. Law and order comes first. Asserting control comes first, looking after the people comes second, and then types of government and ideology and constitutions and elections come after that. You have got to make sure that you do not create a vacuum or allow things to boil over that have been released as an unintended consequence of your action. That was where things began to go wrong for the coalition in Iraq.
And being so that has to do with the number of forces that you put on the ground there.
Or that you use the forces that are there already, or you enlarge the coalition to put more forces on the ground. There were three sources of greater strength in security: American forces, wider coalition, or Iraqis, and none of them were used.
No wider American, no American, additional American forces, no.
We didn't attract other coalition contributors.
Why was that?
Because there was a feeling of illegitimacy in what we're doing.
So they didn't want to be part of it?
The ones with
it
the
wasn't greatest that you didn't want to listen to them, didn't want to say, come in and we'll take you into council.
They didn't want to play the game.
From the get-go?
Yeah.
After the war started, didn't want to play?
No.
And thirdly, Iraqis has been the Iraqi training of Iraqi forces has been badly damaged because the members of the Iraqi army fled or went somewhere, and B, there was no distinction between Ba'athists who supported the regime, the previous regime, and Ba'athists who simply did it in order to get a job.
Well, what the Iraqi government is now doing, and we've had this week in London, the president of Iraq, Jalal Talabani talking about this, is to try and reconstitute the Iraqi army and the security forces from a large number of those who were in those forces and trained under Saddam. That is, he's confident, the government is confident there, that they can retrain these people whose loyalty was not to Saddam. If we can do it now in 2005, why weren't we doing it in 2003? We could have made a distinction.
Why weren't we?
I believe that it was felt at the time that the change could be made to a stable new Iraq without using the people from the old Iraq, that a clean break needed to be made.
So that was a critical misassumption.
Well, the clean break meant that 200,000 or 300,000 Iraqi soldiers were allowed home without pay and with their weapons. That doesn't seem to have been a very good answer.
When will your book be published?
I don't know. I don't know. I'm not commenting on that. I'll wait and see how my proper negotiations with my authorities are going.
This is not a case, and I ask this because this has been written about, of you having of you reporting on conversations with the Prime Minister or others in the book that they were surprised at.
Well, different people will have different views on what they want to see in public. I think I've been talking about issues of substance that became public at the time or since. I'm not revealing anything new, but I'm giving a little bit of detail about my part in it and of the general nature of the conversations that I had, but I'm not revealing anything that is substantially and confidentially new.
And nothing that Prime Minister wouldn't be...
Well, that's up to his people to advise. It's not... This is with the Foreign Office, it's not with Number 10. The Prime Minister hasn't seen the book.
One last question. Do I hear you saying the most important lesson to be learned out of the Iraqi experience, from your vantage point, notwithstanding everything we've said, is that you better understand the consequences and what can go wrong before you launch something that has the potential, beyond whatever good might happen, of being a horrendous foreign policy blunder?
Perhaps it's part of the more decadent spirit of the Brits and their history, that they think more pessimistically about this, and that the more dynamic society, the United States, is always thinking, we are going to create the best case scenario. It's going to work. We have the power to do it. We over-insure, perhaps. You under-insure. I think in a case like Iraq, which may never be repeated, it may not happen that way again, the under-insurance has been very expensive.
Thank you for coming.
Pleasure to be with you.
Sir Jeremy Greenstock, former UN ambassador, former envoy to Iraq, now head of the Ditchley Foundation. Thank you for joining us from London. See you next time.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
The Coca-Cola system sponsors youth sporting events in the United States and around the world, like an English soccer tournament for 37,000 girls and boys, satisfying a thirst for healthy living. The Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, my guest host sitting in for me is Michael Eisner, former CEO of Disney, talking to Barry Diller and John Travolta.